Hello, good people, and welcome back. So this is the start of a new series where we're going to try and recreate an award-winning website. So to show you the demo, we're going to try and recreate what you are currently seeing on the screen. And mostly I'm going to try and show you the various tricks that have been used to create and come up with such a website. We're going to be using three.js, JavaScript, and HTML and CSS. So we are not going to be starting from scratch, we are going to be starting from somewhere. So I already have a basic template with the animations on the HTML and the CSS, and then we just have a basic cube, spinning cube. That's where we're going to start from, and mostly this tutorial is going to be majorly on the various things that went into creating this website. Not majorly on the animations, but the tips and tricks that have been used to create the immersive feel on the website. We also have a basic template which already has the basic code to start with, and I'll be putting a link in the description if you want the source code. So we are not going to entirely start from scratch. So this template just renders the box. And so with that, let's get started. I have broken this project into modules where in each video we are going to be handling a specific effect created within the site. Now, because of time and limited resources, I may not cover everything to the animation, but I will be sharing with you some techniques that were used in each section. So in this section, we will be looking at texturing. So the first thing is just to create a loading manager, and the purpose of a loading manager is to keep track of the assets that are being loaded into the project. And we can easily use the loading manager to create a loading animation as we wait for the assets to load. And then afterwards, we can also create a property called loader, which is going to be a GLTF loader for loading the 3D assets, because most of the assets that you're going to use are going to be GLTF, in GLTF format. And then we can pass in the load manager so that it can keep track of all the GLTF models that you are loading into the 3.js application. We can also go ahead and do the same for the images, which are also going to be used as textures. So we are going to use the built-in texture loader that comes with 3.js. After that, we can go ahead and do some cleanup. So we are going to the load items method. We are going to remove the box that we had created that was acting as the placeholder. We can also remove it from the scene as we will not be needing it. Then we can go ahead and start loading the 3D objects that we need for the scene. So the first one, it's going to be the helix, which I'm going to load it in a bit, and then we can go ahead and traverse the GLTF scene, and the GLTF is what is returned after we have loaded the GLTF object. So we can go ahead and traverse the GLTF scene. And this returns a child. And so what we can do is we can check if the child has a material. And if so, we will be replacing the material with a custom material, which we are going to be creating in a bit. So that material is going to be helix material. Then we can go up and I'm just going to be importing some of the assets that you're going to need, and so I won't be typing them, so I'll just copy from a finished project, and I'm just going to be pasting them right here. And then we can load some of the textures into three.js, the textures that you're going to be needing. And since we are going to be using matcaps all through, I can just go ahead and create an object to house them all. And so I'm going to say this.matcaps, and it is going to be an object. And so here we are going to be loading the textures using the image loader that we had declared earlier. So we're going to say image loader, and it has a property, it has a method called load, which is going to load the texture that we pass in. So for the helix, we can say the white matcap, then we can duplicate this a number of times, and then we can give them the appropriate names and the reference to what they hold. So after giving them the appropriate names and the references, the next thing we can do now is we can declare the material that we had already given the helix children earlier. And so we're just going to make a comment here, and it's going to be creation of the materials. So creating materials. So then we can implement the material. It was called helix material. And because most of the objects, actually it's all of the objects that we are loading into the scene are using matcap materials, we can go ahead and say new 3.matcap material. And for the object in the scene, for the helix, you're going to be using the helix matcap material. And so we can say matcap, the matcap property, you can say this.matcaps, and then you can reference the helix. We're also going to be creating a parent object for the 3D objects. So these are just going to be object 3D that we are going to be using as parents to the objects that we load onto the scene. So I'm just going to create some comments here, and then afterwards I can create the helix parent, which is going to be a parent to the helix, to the gltf.scene of the helix object that we had loaded earlier. So we're going to give it a name helix, and it's just going to be a 3-dot object 3D. And so after this, we can go over to where we had declared the, where we had loaded the GLTF. And so we can add the GLTF scene onto the helix parent that we had declared earlier. So we can say this.helix.add, and we can add in the GLTF.scene. And then we can go ahead and add the helix to the scene. So you can say this to scene.add and then the helix. And so this is the result. Now we can go ahead and adjust the position of the GLTF model to make it match slightly what we are seeing on the original site. So I'm going to go here and position the helix parent, which is this.helix. We're going to say helix.position, and on the x-axis we're going to position it on 30. We're going to say 30. We can duplicate this a number of times because you're going to do the same for the y and for the z. And so for the y, we can do minus 20. And then here we can say 60, minus 60. We can also go ahead and adjust the rotations. And so on the x-axis, you're going to use math.py. Sorry. And you're going to divide it by 3. You can do the same for the y. You're not going to do the same for the x. So the x and the y-axis. And for the y-axis, you're going to say divided by 4.5. And so we can change this to y. And also we can change this one. We had not changed it. X. So we have the object, but it lacks the details that we have seen in the original site. And so let's go ahead and add that. So we can do that by using normal maps, which we will plug it into the bump map property of the material. And we are going to use the normal map, but the results are not what we are quite looking for. So we are going to make adjustments to the normal texture that we are using as the bump map so that we can get closer to what we are looking for. So what you can do, you can reference the normal map that is inside the matcap subject. And we are going to modify the wrap S and give it a 3-dot wrapping. I'm going to explain this in a bit. So let me just type them in and then I'll explain them. So this is the explanation. The texture repeat is just how many times the texture is repeated across the surface in each direction, that is U and V. So if we were to unwrap our model into a 2D plane, the texture repeat is just going to wrap the texture that we have onto the U and the V, that is the X and the Y coordinate. And so the texture.wrap S just defines how the texture is going to be wrapped horizontally corresponding to the U, that is U in the UV coordinates. And then the T is just going to do the same, but now on the vertical axis. And so now the method that you're going to be using to wrap the texture onto the model is going to be three.repeat wrapping, which is just wrapping that continues infinitely. Now it doesn't look that off, but still we need to achieve something close to what we want. And so to do that, we just adjust the bump scale to something that is slightly lower than 1. So let's do 0.2 maybe. And there you have it. It's closer to what we wanted to achieve. And so that's it for this tutorial. So I would like to thank you for sticking around until this point. This is just the first one, and we have around 3 more. So if you like this tutorial, you can go ahead and subscribe. You can also go ahead and support me by getting the source code over on Patreon. If you want more news on what I'm working on, you can follow me on Twitter. And you can also subscribe at applied3js.com. Also, you can go ahead and hit that like button. My name is Gideon Shuja, and as always, keep grinding.